All right, so we left off about here, and we are talking about atoms. And now that we know a little bit about atoms, we know that they are made out of subatomic particles. And those subatomic particles that you need to know are protons and neutrons, which are found in the nucleus, and electrons that go around on the outside. And we've learned that protons are positively charged, electrons are negatively charged, and neutrons, they're neutral. They don't have a charge. So we're learning some definitions. And one of the definitions that you need to know is atomic number. The atomic number of any given element is going to be the number of protons that are found in the nucleus of their atoms. So for example, the atomic number for carbon is 6. That means any atom of carbon has got 6 protons in the nucleus. If I told you that in my hand I had some carbon, but it had 7 protons in the nucleus, you would have to say, well, then you don't have carbon, okay? Because carbon's got an atomic number of 6, which means all of its atoms have got 6 protons in the nucleus. The atomic number. Now, the mass number is going to be the number of protons plus the number of neutrons. When it comes to how much something weighs, the mass of it for a certain number of its atoms, when it comes to that, you add up the number of protons and the number of neutrons. Do the electrons weigh something? They weigh something, but they don't weigh very much. So let's go here. I'm going to draw something. Back. All right. So if I were to tell you that I have got in my hand an element and its atomic number is 9 and its mass number is 21, tell me how many neutrons does it have? So you would say the atomic number is 9. Oops, I didn't do that right. If the atomic number is 9 then that means it has 9 protons. Well, that's just not working at all. It's got 9 protons, okay? And I told you that its mass number was 21. So that's its mass number, okay? So how many neutrons does it have? It has 12 neutrons. Why? Because if you add up the protons and the neutrons, you get the mass number. Alrighty. So when we're talking about elements, we're talking about the periodic table. The periodic table of elements is sort of like, you know, the thing you put on a t-shirt when you want people to know that your movie character is a nerd. Right? It's kind of the symbol for science. And elements are individually listed here. Each element has got a unique mass number. Every element has got its own mass number. So here you can see carbon has got an atomic number 6, so it has 6 protons, a mass number of 12. So most of the atoms of carbon have got 6 neutrons as well. So these are all the elements. Now, from biology point of view, we only care about some of these, which is why my mastery of chemistry is not as good as yours probably will be very soon, or might already be. But I do want you to know the 12 chemical symbols for the elements that are critical to human life. You know, they call them chemical symbols like it's going to be an apple or something like that, but they're not icons. They're really just the abbreviations. And you need to know 12 of them. Let's start with the easy ones. By the way, I told you in the introductory part of the class that it is a good strategy while you're watching these lecture videos to have already printed up the study guide, so you can be answering study guide questions as you're listening to lecture. Here's a place where this is actually written in the study guide so you could fill it in. So these guys are the easy ones. Oxygen, carbon, hydrogen. Most of the weight of every living thing, whether it's a tree or a blue whale or you and I, is made out of oxygen, carbon, and hydrogen. But also nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur. These guys, what is their chemical symbol? It is the first letter of the word. So for oxygen, it's O. For carbon, it's C. For hydrogen, it's the letter H, hydrogen. For nitrogen, it's the letter N. There you are over there. For phosphorus, it's the letter P. For sulfur, it's the letter S, right? So we got those out of the way. That's five right there. Now these three, these are pretty easy. The letter C got used as the symbol for carbon. So what are we gonna do with calcium and chlorine? Well, for calcium, we made it Ca. And for chlorine, we made it Cl. Cl. Magnesium. Magnesium is Mg, right? Those are pretty easy. Then we have got three of them that are hard. Sorry, they're just hard. And the reason is that their chemical symbol was assigned based on the Greek word for the element. So for potassium, the chemical symbol is the letter K. For sodium, the chemical symbol is capital N, lowercase a. And for iron, the chemical symbol is capital F, lowercase e. Ready? So make sure you know that, because on the exam, there's going to be a question like, the chemical symbols for calcium and sodium are, and you need to know Ca and Na, right? Oh, yeah, nerd humor. I hear oxygen and magnesium are dating, and I was like, OMG, because the chemical symbol for oxygen is O, and the chemical symbol for magnesium is Mg. Yeah, I got lots of these. So we've talked about quite a bit. Let's talk about electrons now. The reason that we're talking about atoms at all is so I can talk to you about electrons, because understanding electrons will allow us to understand how molecules get put together. Now, electrons are kind of orbiting around the nucleus. Are they actually orbiting the way the moon orbits the Earth? No, not exactly. But it's okay to think of it that way, as long as you're in biology. I'm not even going to explain the way it really works, okay? Now, even though the electrons are orbiting the nucleus, they're not doing it randomly. We don't just have a whole bunch of electrons just woo. No. They are in what are called electron shells. The first electron shell is the shell that is closest to the nucleus, and it is only capable of holding two electrons. So once there is an atom, that let's imagine the atom has got three electrons in it. Well, the first two will go into the first electron shell, but that third electron needs to go in the next shell outward, all right? The first electron shell can hold two, and then it's filled. The next one and the third one, they can each hold eight, right? The first electron shell can hold two, the outermost electron shell can hold eight. Now, if you are talking about elements that are bigger than the ones we're going to be talking about, things are different, but I'm just going to set that aside, okay? Remember, two for the first one, eight for the other ones. So one of the questions that you're going to bump into on exam one is going to be something like, I have got an atom. It has got an atomic number of seven. How many electrons are in its outer shell? How many vacancies are in its outer shell? Let's do that, okay? Here's nitrogen. It's got an atomic number of seven. If it doesn't have any charge, no net charge, then it'll have seven protons and seven electrons. Great. Seven electrons. It is going to put two electrons in the first electron shell. Great. Now it's got five left over, and so it'll have five in the outer electron shell, because the outer electron shell can hold 8, but right now it's got 5 in it. That means the outer electron shell has got 3 vacancies. Yes, this is a very stupid game right now, but actually it's going to mean something in another slide or two. Okay, so make sure that you can do that. Oxygen's got an atomic number of 8. When it has no charge, how many electrons does it have? An atomic number of 8 means it's got 8 protons. If it has no net charge, it has 8 electrons. The first 2 electrons go in the first shell, that leaves 6 more. So there are 6 electrons in the outer electron shell, and it could hold 8, so that leaves 2 vacancies, right? Let's go ahead and do it with magnesium. It's got an atomic number of 12. How many protons does magnesium have? Dumb question, 12, already? Now, I've written here that's got 12 neutrons. Do you need to memorize that? Oh, please don't, right? Don't memorize any rules for it. The only thing you need to know about neutrons is that they're neutral, that they're calculated in the atomic mass the atomic mass. You need to know that, right? So how many electrons are in the outer electron shell? Well, we've got 12 protons and it's got no charge. So we're gonna put the first 2 in the first shell, and then we've got 10 more to go. So the next shell, we will put electrons 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay, we still have 2 more to go. So the outer electron shell holds 2. So the outer electron shell has got 2 electrons. How many vacancies? 6 vacancies, right? So go ahead and practice those. Now, what is the atomic number of this element? Well, it says right there it's got 13 protons, so the atomic number is 13, okay? What's its mass number? For the mass number, we take the number of protons and add the number of neutrons, so the mass number for this element is 25. Simple, right? Now, what did I do here? Yeah, I know I added all those words, but look, it has got a different number of neutrons. Is it the same element as this one? Yes, because the atomic number, the number of protons, dictates which element it is. I don't know what this element is, okay? But that is going to be what dictates what element it is. This one, boom, same number of protons, but different number of neutrons. So it's the same element, but it's different somehow. How do we describe that? We would say that this one with a mass number of 25, and this one with a mass number of 27, that these guys are the same element, but they are different isotopes, okay? Here we go. Isotopes are atoms that have the same atomic number, they're the same element, but they have different mass numbers, a different number of neutrons, right? Now, when you think about isotopes, you're probably thinking, oh, that means they're radioactive. Not always, okay? Being an isotope can make an atom radioactive, but not all isotopes are radioactive. And by the way, by convention, we generally refer to the most common version of the element as like being the element. And then whatever is the less common thing, we call, the isotope. For example, carbon 12, almost all the carbon that you bump into on a day-to-day basis, and we're mostly made out of it, almost all of it is carbon 12. So we have a tendency to call that carbon, and then because it's got 6 protons and 6 neutrons, and then carbon 13 has got 6 protons and 7 neutrons, we call that an isotope. But don't worry about the technicality. I'm not going to quiz you on it, okay? Oh, what do we need to know here? What is a hydrogen ion? All right, let's put together some of the stuff we've been talking about, right? Hydrogen has got an atomic number of 1, and it generally has got a mass number of 1. And that's because almost all the hydrogen around you has got a single proton in the nucleus of its atoms, and no neutron. Now, when hydrogen has no charge, it has a single electron. So technically, an uncharged hydrogen atom looks like this picture here. One proton, one electron. Now, for reasons we're about to talk about at the beginning of the next lecture, atoms don't like this situation. They don't like having a vacancy in their outer electron shell. Hydrogen's got one electron and one vacancy, and it does not like that. And it solves that problem in a couple of ways. One way it solves the problem is by giving away its electron. That's one way it solves its problem. Now, if hydrogen gives away its electron, two things happen. One thing is it becomes an ion, because I told you that whenever there is not an equal number of protons and electrons, then that atom or molecule will have a charge. So technically it will be an ion, and it will have a charge of plus one. Also, just have a look at this hydrogen atom. If you took away an electron, what do you have left? You just have a proton, okay? Hydrogen's got an atomic number of one. It's got one proton in its nucleus. If it has no charge, it'll have one electron. What does a hydrogen atom look like when it loses its electron? It is just going to be a naked proton, okay? So a hydrogen ion is a proton. And a hydrogen ion is a proton. That's not working. A hydrogen ion is a proton, and a hydrogen ion is also abbreviated plus H with a plus next to it. We'll start off there in the next lecture.